Diversification of investment. These are the smartest things that countries can do today. Turkey does it, Kazakhstan does it, Saudi Arabia does it, Brazil does it. These are the countries that we are all looking to. We're saying these are the countries that are going to be smart and be leaders in the 21st century, and every Arab country should do that. Let me just, before we get
to the questions,
let me get back to these questions. The European Union is, yes, there are a couple of economies stumbling in the European Union, but the European Union is the reason those economies were growing in the first place. As soon as a country joins the European Union, as they have in large numbers since the 70s and 80s, their investment profile immediately increases. The amount of foreign investment they get immediately increases. I don't think anyone in Ireland or Greece regrets the fact that they were made members of the European Union. It's the best thing that ever happened to them, and now it's the thing that will bail them out. And even the people in France and in Germany need to remember, as they're bailing out these countries, that when the large economies were not growing in the last 10 years, the European economies that were growing were these new ones on the periphery. So they have a dynamic relationship and they will find a balance, but they are all much, much, much better off. Economic union and political integration and so forth comes down to developing complementarities and so forth. In the Arab world, it's a bit more difficult because of the fact that there's similar exports in many of the economies. But there are other complementarities that can be developed, and I don't think we have time to really get into it too much right now. Let me getting back to the map, and I apologize if I'm speaking too quickly. I'm sure you noticed I did not actually remove any of the political barriers. I did not say Syria should disappear, Lebanon should disappear, Egypt should disappear, the Gulf country should disappear. What the prominent lines on my map are the lines that cross the borders. You can still have the borders. You are still Lebanese. You are still Saudi. You are still Jordanian. But you can still build those lines across. Those are the ones that unite. Those are the ones that create. Why just talk about unity all the time? You can't just talk about it. Anyone can talk about it. My message is you can build it. And there are many ways to build it. And by the way, you know, there are resources that you have to share through that infrastructure. Human resources that flow across so that your territories are built, energy resources, water resources. The only way you share those things across between Arab countries that have them and Arab countries that don't is through infrastructure, not through...
You have like 30 seconds to wrap up, so we can move to the questions on the other side.
The last thing was about... Obama and dictatorships and democracy. I mean, you know, I was a very big critic of the Bush administration because they talked about democracy more than any other government of the past. And I think they tricked a lot of people. They tricked a lot of Arab commentators as well, unfortunately. They tricked Americans. They tricked everyone. Because they used the word democracy so much that we start to associate the Bush administration with this notion of democracy promotion. They did not promote democracy. It was not really what they did. The policy towards Egypt and so forth did not change. Therefore, they were not really in the business of promoting democracy as such. So I refuse this association. The United States has a very mixed policy. Sometimes it supports democracy, other times it doesn't. It's obviously very case-by-case basis. I unfortunately am not the person who dictates how the United States makes its policy towards individual countries, but I will say this. Democracy is not the priority of the United States government, even if they say it is. It was not the priority for Bush, and in my personal opinion, it does not appear to be for Obama either. I think what's more important, and this is in my academic work, I believe that the notions around good governance and the literature and the research and the metrics that are going to defining service delivery, public welfare, a rule of law, accountable administration, all of these things are very important. And that's what builds a stable society. Today we talk about an Asia model, a China model, a Singapore model. Those aren't democracies, but they're successful. I think we should be looking at what are the ingredients of success, and democracy can be one of them, but it's not always one of them.
Now we'll go for 5 or 7 questions on this side. Please be as short as possible so we can have time for Parag to answer them and not interrupt the schedule of this day. Let's start with the gentleman over there.
Thank you. أنا بدي أحكي بالعربي. بدي أحكي بالعربي. سؤالي أو هو مش سؤال صراحة أكثر منه استهجان. من الكلمة اللي قال عنها الأستاذ نعم. خانة بأنه الخريطة كانت أرتستيك. هو كتب ثيوري وعمل خريطة لهي الثيوري وبالآخر بقول عنه أرتستيك. مش شايف أي يعني أي تفسير لكلمة أرتستيك بأنه إذا تم اعتماد هاي النظرية لحتى تأثر على حياة الشعوب مش بس الشعوب العربية كل شعوب العالم. مش شايف وين الأرتستيك بهالموضوع. ممكن أشتغل بالفن التشكيلي وأقول عنه أرتستيك بس مش بمصير البشر وأقول عنه أرتستيك.
الشاب لو سمحت شكرا.
Thank you very much. My name is Hassan Al-Umair. My question to Mr. Khan. First of all of us believe, whether people like it or not, United States is one of the leading country worldwide. But don't you think, Mr. Khan, if United States play the role of a consultant instead of interfering on others' issues, don't you think that the future and the situation of the region and all the parts worldwide will be better than the situation right now?
You go for the gentleman in the back next to the camera.
Assalamu alaikum. Ali al-Faqih from Saudi. With all respect of your theory, Mr. Khan, just to complete the picture and to let us have a good vision to your theory in terms of accepting or commenting in that, all the items being included in your theory was just talking about the rosy and advantage of having the borderless theory. But I'd like from you to highlight a little bit about what is the disadvantage of having a borderless Middle East. Also, I'd like you to consider the applicability of this theory, given the example of the GCC country, which already they spent more than 25 years trying to make it a borderless, but we couldn't achieve that.
I'll go for the gentleman in the second row, yes.
أول شيء تحية للجميع. اسمي حسن كراجة من فلسطين. أول شيء كيف بعطي الحق لنفسه أنه يشطب الشعب الفلسطيني وأرض فلسطين اللي هي جزء من الوطن العربي وبكتب محلها إسرائيل.
حكينا عن هاي النقطة كتير.
اسمح لي
رح أوضح نقطة مرة واحدة وأخيرة لما نرجع نفوت بذات النقاش مرة أخرى. الخريطة ما انحطت عليها أسماء أو شطبت أسماء للتعبير عن موقف سياسي. الرجل موجود يتحمل مسؤولية هذا الخطأ التقني، اعترف بهذا الخطأ التقني، وأي استنتاج سياسي حول شكل الخريطة بالأمس هو استنتاج لا يمكن أن يكون أبعد عن الحقيقة ولا يمكن أن يكون أبعد عن الواقع. فول ستوب.
بخصوص موضوع اللاجئين للأستاذ براك، كيف بدأ يرجعهم على فلسطين وكيف بدأ يرسم لهم الخريطة الجديدة في المستقبل؟ ثاني شيء احنا بدنا نحدد مستقبلنا مش جايبين حدا يحدد لنا مستقبلنا. شكرا
لك. رح ياخذ من الشاب بعد رح ياخذ سؤالين ونروح عند براك لانه الوقت بدا يداهمنا.
السلام عليكم. سيف الله المشات من تونس او بالاحرى من المغرب العربي. نعم. الذي لاحظت يا استاذ انك الغيته من استراتيجيه العالم العربي ككل.
Could you kindly change this map next time?
يعني سؤالي العالم العربي.
I'll buy you a map when we get out.
العالم العربي أظن أنه يبدأ من المغرب إلى الخليج. وهنا يأتي السؤال، هل أنه استعمال هذه التسميات الجديدة التي تقصي كلمة أو لفظ العالم العربي بتسمية دول شمال إفريقيا والشرق الأوسط مقصودة؟ نعم. هذا سؤال رقم واحد.
بسرعة. سؤال رقم اثنين
بسرعة. بالنسبة لمشروع الشرق الأوسط الجديد، ما هو مشروع أوباما نظرا لأنك كنت مستشار له في هذا الموضوع؟
نعم.
ما هو مشروعه في تحقيق مشروع الشرق الأوسط الجديد؟ وشكرا.
راح روح عند الجنتلمان in the back. yes.
شكرا سيدي. نحن في فلسطين منذ مطلع القرن الماضي نسمع مبادرات وحسن نوايا شيء عن الديمقراطية، عن حسن الجوار، عن السلام.
نعم.
وصلنا إلى حد أننا لن نستطيع أن نوقف بناء حجر واحد في مستوطنة واحدة في فلسطين. كيف نتحدث عن أي شيء قبل اعتراف العالم بأننا شعب يستحق الأرض ويستحق الدولة ويستحق أن يكون له وطن. ليس هناك مبادرات مقبولة للشعب الفلسطيني سيدي إلا بإقرار حق. لو سمح
سؤال مهم جدا، فكرة واضحة وسؤال جدا مهم، دعنا نبدأ من هذا السؤال بالإجابات مع براك.
فضلت نقطة واحدة
شرف،
أود أن أفهم من السيد المتحدث نقطة واحدة، كيف نستطيع أن نأخذ موقف أمريكي والشارع الأمريكي لم يتجاوز تأييده للقضية العربية أكثر من 18% والباقي لإسرائيل على مر كل السنوات الماضية؟
شكرا جزيلا. بعتقد بناخذ بعد سؤال أخير 30 ثانية لو سمحت لننتقل للإجابة.
حاول اختصر قدر الاستطاعة. علي الصمد استاذ جيوبوليتيك بجامعة مونبلية تروا وبالجامعة اللبنانية. سؤالي هو عن المسألة الإيرانية. نحن نعتقد أن الصراع بين إيران والمجتمع الدولي هو ليس بين الخير والشر، بين الشرق والغرب. نعتقد بأن المجتمع الدولي يحاول أن يطوع النظام الإيراني ويحاول أن يسحب منه أدوات قوته، وفي الطرف المقابل فإن إيران تحاول أن تنتزع شرعية دولية لاستمرارية نظامها ونظام الإسلامي. السؤال هو، هل تعتقدون كما نعتقد بأن سيكون هناك تسوية على المستوى الدولي تمنح من خلالها المجتمع الدولي، يمنح من خلالها إيران حق الاستمرارية لنظامها نظام ولاية الفقيه؟ وشكرا. أم أنكم ترون أن هناك سيناريو آخر؟ شكرا.
Parag, I guess we'll start with the question about Palestine. The U.S. failure to free settlements is really frustrating the Middle East. It's fading the hope concerning the peace process, not only in Palestine, but in all the Arab world. What this make practically of the American status in the region, the disadvantages of the borderless Middle East, gentlemen asked about, and I guess these are the two major questions that have been issued, and I'm sure you have so much notes to talk about.
Say a few quick things. First of all, this is not a theory. A theory is a predictive model. This is not a theory. This is a series of arguments, and that's why we're engaged in an argument, because an argument begets a counter-argument. But this is not a theory. And when it comes to artwork and graphics, the one that I put up about Palestine, I urge you to look on the website of the RAND Corporation, which has produced the most sophisticated graphic design and artwork proposing what would be the united infrastructure of an independent Palestinian state connecting the West Bank and Gaza. This is precisely what I spoke about yesterday. This is the proposal that I have been championing. And this is clearly not evidence that I'm saying that that I have eliminated Palestine. I mean, I saw my own slides as well. Who thinks I eliminated Palestine from the map? I have an entire big slide showing this is what there should be, a united Palestinian independent state. Who supports that idea? Please raise your hand if you believe there should be an independent Palestinian state. Okay, thank you. All of those.
So the majority agrees with you.
Okay, I would like to think so. Let's get over that. In terms of borders, I'm tackling one slice of a much larger picture. I'm not the only speaker at this conference. In the last session, we talked about a whole set of problems and challenges that face this region that are internal. That's not my responsibility, as it were. I know that I'm talking about one very, very specific thing, and I'm making one very specific argument that represents maybe 5% of an approach, an overall approach that the Arab world would need to move in a progressive direction. 5% of it is what I'm talking about. So just 5%. The inertia of political borders and the need to transcend them, because it creates a positive dynamic economically and politically otherwise towards a more harmonious Arab world. That's it. So we need to put everything in context. The GCC community is an interesting example. It has existed for 2 decades now. And as I've told a couple of you in private conversations, I've just completed a study of the benefits of GCC integration. Very little of that had been done with concrete numbers. And I have been been tracking precisely what benefits have come from cross-border investment, from projects and infrastructure among the GCC countries, in labor migration possibilities in the GCC. And unfortunately, it will require that an outside person like me comes to do this research, to put together this material. But I have found that GCC has been a beneficial entity economically and strategically, and I hope that it continues to develop, and therefore, yes, it is an interesting role model. The Maghreb, I have a... This is a very long presentation, actually, and I've only shown you 3 slides out of about 40. But I have an entire set of slides, actually, about the North Africa and the Maghreb. And I analyze the concept of the Mediterranean Union and the question as to whether or not such a an entity or zone is emerging. If you look at the patterns and relationships between European countries and Maghreb countries, and I find that the growing economic integration, whether it's physical connection of oil pipelines and gas pipelines under the Mediterranean, or whether it is the amount of investment coming from Europe into Morocco, Tunisia, and so forth, into real estate and other sectors, and job creation, construction. In all of these ways, you are actually finding increasingly that, there is such a thing as a Mediterranean Union. And I think that's a very good thing. I think it shows that the Maghreb countries, yes, they are Arab, or mostly Arab, in fact, but not entirely. Are looking in different directions. They're not just looking to be part of the Arab unity for the sake of it, but they're looking at their geography and saying, how can we take advantage of Europe here and European interest here? So I think that that's another example of the sort of inter-regional integration that I think is a very good thing. Obama, let me just make this last point, or 2 more things. The Obama administration, yes, the United States is a very powerful superpower. I've written extensively about that. But clearly, the only word that's fair and not too harsh to describe this question, to answer this question about the strategy, is one word: improvisation. And I'm sorry to be using that word. It's unfortunate that I have to use that word. But I think that that is a fair description of what the Obama administration's situation is. Globally, they inherited 2 conflicts which have been cost enormous lives and resources. They're unable to focus on the sort of positive agenda that in a perfect world they might have wanted to pursue. And they will be improvising for a long time, which is another reason why I don't believe that anyone in this room or any country in this part of the world should be waiting for deliverance and waiting for the solution to come from them, because they're improvising. And I do believe, because I do have many...